Okay, so anyway, and then the last verse of the chapter, he says, he uses the word thanks in a different connotation, so now I have to figure this out too. There he says, thanks also to the Most High for his unspeakable gift. Notice he says the unspeakable gift. Now we just spent a bunch of time saying, speaking the words out of our mouth. What's he using the word unspeakable gift for? Well, the only thing that I could come up with so far is this. There are not enough words to contain love or the gift of eternal life. There's not enough words to describe it, to contain its description. Because the Most High is infinite, right? The description and the amount of words to describe what love is in its proper context is infinite. Infinite, man. So it's the unspeakable gift. That's the only thing I could get out of that so far. So anyway, so let's look at some of the this's and the that's and see if we can pinpoint things here now. So we have a little more time. Okay. Just go to verse 10. And may he, we know who he is, that's Yeshua, who is supplying seed to the sower, the sower is them, the church, and bread for food, supply and multiply your sown seed, and increase the fruits of your righteousness, okay, in everything being enriched to all liberality that does work through us, thanksgiving. So that does sound like he's talking about everybody. So I'm just going to make a note. Okay. I'll just put here the brethren. Brethren. All churches. Okay. And then because the ministration of this service, okay, that's the one that I was wondering about. What service is he talking about? Okay, I want to be of this service, not only is supplying the wants of the saints or the lack, but is also abounding through many thanksgiving. Okay, through the proof of this ministration. So here he uses this ministration and this service. Oh. Through the proof of this ministration, glorifying the Most High for the subjection of your confession to the good news of the anointed for the liberality of the fellowship to them, to the fellowship of them. Okay, now who is them? We have an idea, but we want to be specific. And by their supplication, okay, and then by their supplication in your behalf, longing after you because of the exceeding grace. Okay, and by their supplication, okay, who's there? That has to be the Macedonians, because we know it's the Macedonians, because the Macedonians are the ones that are wanting to send them knowledge. And so their supplication is like their prayer, their hope in your behalf. So your is the Corinthians. Okay, so in their behalf, so this. Now, in their behalf, in their supplication, in their behalf, that could be the brethren, Titus, the brother, and the third guy. So, we won't write anything there yet. Longing after you because of the exceeding grace of the Most High. So, there's that word exceeding again. That's always has to do with connecting to love. Because remember, let's go to Ephesians, and he uses chapter 3, verse 19. To know also the love of the anointed that is exceeding the knowledge. All right? So that's why he says, because of the exceeding grace. In other words, the love. This is just another way of describing love, the exceeding grace. It's the manifold wisdom of the Most High. Because of the exceeding grace upon you. In other words, the exceeding grace that's upon you, right? In other words, your willingness to see it through to the very end, to become mature, it's upon you. And Paul says, I'm boasting that you'll finish it. All right. So let's read Ephesians 3:19 again. To know also the love of the anointed that is exceeding the knowledge. What's exceeding the knowledge? The love. The love that is exceeding the knowledge. The love that. The word that is connected to the love. It's describing the love. That is exceeding the knowledge, that you may be filled to all the fullness. All the fullness. And to him who is able above all things to do exceeding abundantly what we ask or think, according to the power that is working in us. Okay. That word power there, I've been coming across that word power. And it also has a connotation toward that has to do with speaking the truth. Reason I say that is because Paul says in one of the somewhere in one of his letters he says it was in the 1 Corinthians. It was chapter 5. Let's go there. He says, shall I come it was connected to the story in chapter 5. Okay. See if I can find it. Here it is. Well, here's one of them anyway. Here's one of the things for power. Okay, so let's before we speak of that, let's Ephesians 3:20. So I'm gonna make references here. Come on, bud. And then 1 Corinthians 5:4. Okay, look how power, the word power is used here. Verse 3. For indeed, as being absent to the body and present as to the spirit, have already judged as being present with him who worked this thing. In the name of our Lord Yeshua the Anointed, you being gathered together, also my spirit, with the power of our Lord Yeshua, deliver up such a one to the adversary for the destruction of the flesh. Right? In other words, with the power. In other words, with words that cannot be disagreed with, right? So, just for another little thinking about this with the power, you know. In other words, to speak words to him that have authority, that have truth to them, even though he might not understand the truth, but the words have power. So, you know, let the brother know, hey, we're not bringing the law of Moses in here. Yeah. Right? And so the brother would try to convince them otherwise. Oh, the law of Moses is good. And then they start getting into a discussion about it. And as soon as they could tell that guy is just adamant about not wanting to change at that time, he's not ready to change, and then they kick him out. So the power. So here we have power in connection with, you know, with having the right to also go to the authorities or the police, bring the police in, say, hey, we don't want this guy around. Right? And so the police would say, okay, they don't want you around. You got to go, buddy. That's a form of power, and it's in connection with words spoken. But there's another instance where the police could not be involved in this one. This other use of the word power. See if I could find it. He says something about, shall I come to you with a whip? So it might be the Ephesians. Here's another one that has to do with power. Ephesians chapter 1, verse 19. And what the exceeding greatness of his power to us who are believing. Okay, so now we have the word power as in connection with the power of the Most High, as in Satan could not defeat him because he's 100% perfect. Perfect love. Perfect love of Yahweh. I'm just using Yahweh because it's short to write it out. So I'm looking for that place where he talks about the use of power. He says, shall I come to you with a whip? Oh, it might have been the Colossians. Yeah, I just did a study in Colossians. Oh, this is probably where that word works is connected to speaking. Oh, here it is. And there's that word power again. Look at that, power. He says here in the Colossians, for this also I labor, striving according to his working, that is working in power in me. What is it that's working with power in him? The words of truth that are being spoken out of his mouth. The understanding of what perfection really is. Okay, quarreling. Okay, this. Well, I went to. Okay, here's Timothy. I did a little bit in Timothy. Having a form of piety and its power having denied. Yeah, because the words trying to defend the law of Moses to be used in our life. Is power denied? Those words have no power.